Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Agatha H. and the Siege of Mechanicsburg by Phil Foglio and Kaja Foglio. Narrated by Angela Dawe. Prologue. 20 years ago. Lucretia Monkfish slotted the last components securely into their places inside the great engine, slapped the hatch closed, and cackled. Her assistant, the defrocked priestess Mozek, shuddered at the sound.
"You shouldn't be getting so worked up, mistress," the old woman said as she tightened the final bolts. "Not in your condition."
Mozek felt the presence of Glimtoka, the taciturn Geisterdama who never left Lucretia's side, looming beside her. She didn't bother to look up at the frowning warrior.
"And don't you even pretend you don't agree with me, White Eyes."
The Geister snarled at the overly familiar address, and Mozek fully expected to feel the usual stinging rap to the back of her head. Instead, to her astonishment, she heard the warrior clearing her little-used throat. Mozek had diligently studied the language of the Pale Ladies, partly because it helped serve her mistress's purposes, and partly because she learned many potentially life-saving secrets when people didn't think she could understand them.
"Your slave speaks truly, lady. Her impertinence rises in a legitimate cause. If she who you carry within you is indeed the holy child..."
Lucretia ended this by slapping Glimtoka sharply across the face.
"Silence!"
She stamped her foot.
"I've told you that stupid prophecy is wrong. It is predicated on failure. My failure."
She spun about and regarded the two figures that were strapped to the large steel tables. One of them, a furious construct of flesh, metal, and black leather, writhed impotently against her bonds. She roared, cursing Lucretia in old French.
"That which you have done here is blasphemy."
"Oh, I know."
Lucretia hugged herself and twirled about.
"It's so exciting. I'm positively giddy."
Lucretia's pirouette took her to the other table. Strapped to this one was a clank made all of metal in the shape of an angel almost 3 meters tall. Even restrained, it was quite imposing, although it was evident it had been neglected for quite a while. Its clothing was frayed and tattered. Its wig, once elegantly coiffed, was now a dusty rat's nest sliding from its place. The great wings were now little more than almost bare struts, still adorned with a few tarnished silver foil feathers. Its face, as well as the rest of its body, was still and lifeless.
"But not for long," Lucretia promised herself.
She turned back to the other slab while patting the inert clank.
"I'd think you'd be glad to be out of this old thing. I mean, it must have been terribly boring being chained up in that forgotten hallway for over 100 years.
To Lucretia's discomfort, her words merely caused her prisoner to smile. Lucretia felt ghostly icicles of dread slide down her spine.
"You have no idea what it was like,"
the creature on the slab said with obvious relish.
"But I take comfort in knowing that if you continue in this madness, you will."
Lucretia considered giving this impudent wretch a slap as well, but even shackled, there were those terrible teeth. They had seemed like such a funny idea at the time. She was saved from further indecision by the sound of Mozek clearing her throat.
"It is done, mistress."
Lucretia looked over her minion's work and could find no fault. Thick cables were now attached to the metal figure. The engines themselves were awash with green lights as they quietly thrummed.
"It won't work, Lady Heterodyne."
The creature on the slab's voice was different now. There was no trace of anger or malice. It was a voice that begged to be heeded.
"You are attempting to pour the ocean into a teacup."
She glanced at the prone figure beside her.
"And you have actually found a teacup strong enough to hold it."
Lucretia tipped her head to one side as she considered the construct.
"That's very impressive, that voice thing. Some sort of harmonic pitch. Is that how you got old Andronicus to actually listen to you?"
She patted the inert clank.
"It might actually have worked if you'd been able to use your original vocal mechanisms, but even so, it was very persuasive. I'll have to remember that."
She strode over to the switches.
But I am tired of listening to you, tired of being under the thumb of my husband's house, and tired of being a good little wife. She gestured towards Mozek, who threw the first switch. There was a hum and then a roar. The lights flickered, and the air became heavy as unseen and malevolent the vast presence of Castle Heterodyne filled the room.
What is this place?
The castle sounded confused.
It is a part of me, yet it is not.
It paused.
Lady Heterodyne,
it said in a voice filled with suspicion.
This is your doing. You are meddling where you should not.
Lucretia laughed scornfully.
And that is the last time you will tell me what I should or should not do.
She grasped the final switch.
Things are going to be different around here.
With a shout of triumph, she threw the switch. And things were very different indeed. Now, where were we? Chapter 1. Lucretia blinked as she awoke. She had been outdoors with dear Klaus. Footnote, a scene detailed at the end of one of our previous textbooks, Agatha H. and the Clockwork Princess. This was the first time the Lady Lucretia had possessed the Lady Heterodyne. End footnote. She had him and his empire very nearly under her thumb, but now he was gone, and she was indoors. She realized with surprise that she was in the secret laboratory she had established beneath Castle Heterodyne. Oh, how long had it been since she had worked here, since she had been the young, rebellious spark with such a malicious delight in her schemes? Her head swam. It seemed an eternity. So much had happened to her since then. The room was dusty now, damaged and neglected since the fall of Castle Heterodyne, but she still remembered it well. Someone was standing over her. A girl.
Oh, my goodness. Who?
She began weakly. It couldn't hurt to play vulnerable, put whoever it was off their guard. Looking vulnerable was easy in the body she currently wore, that of the youthful Agatha Heterodyne. The girl looked down at her and smiled.
Hello, Auntie Lucretia. I'm here to help you.
Lucretia rocked back in astonishment as she beheld the face of her long-estranged sister hanging ominously above her. She looked as if she had never aged beyond the carefree days when all three monkfish sisters still lived in their father's fortress and gloried in their fame as the three beautiful daughters of the supremely evil spark, Lucifer Monkfish.
Demonica?
Footnote. Lucifer Monkfish, the reluctant bête noire of the Heterodyne boys, had not one beautiful daughter, but three. The most famous of these was, of course, Lucretia, who eventually wed Bill Heterodyne. Serpentina Monkfish eschewed the family business and ran off with the science adventurer Prince Dumed, while the third, Demonica, remained in the family lair, which occupied an extinct volcano somewhere to the west of Minsk. There, she continued her father's work. You don't hear much about Demonica Monkfish, which is just the way she wanted it. End footnote. Zola laughed in delight.
Yes, everyone says that I look just like dear Maman.
She drew herself up.
But no, I am Zola Anya Talinka Venia Zeblinkaya Malfiasium.
Lucretia looked haunted and glanced around. Her fingers twitched towards a nearby wrench.
First Serpentina's boy, then you. I swear, if Daddy is waiting to pop out from around a chair...
Zola waved a hand dismissively.
Oh, Grandfather died years ago in a freak airship explosion.
Lucretia raised her eyebrows. Zola shrugged.
I know, such a cliché.
Footnote. Airships, at least in the lurid pages of the Fennec Dreadfuls, are expected to, on a regular basis, burst into flames, be attacked by sky pirates, struck by lightning, grapple with air kraken, and be caught up in freakish air currents that swiftly and unerringly transport them thousands of kilometers to hidden civilizations and lost continents. Surprisingly, according to the Empire's records and statistics, this is in fact the case, but it is still the safest form of travel. End footnote.
We still laugh about it at Christmas, but no, it's just me.
Excellent, said Lucretia, as she swung the wrench upward, knocking Zola cold with one smooth blow.
Zola awoke with an aching head and the realization she was restrained. A few subtle tests revealed that whoever had secured her knew her business.
"Now don't bother trying to escape, dear," Lucretia sang out from a workbench. "I gather from the wide variety of items you were carrying, some in rather uncomfortable places, I'd imagine, that you are very well trained."
She used a forceps to exhibit a cleverly made sheath housing several small, wicked-looking knives. She put the knives down and fastidiously wiped the forceps with a moldering rag.
"But you won't get out of that, dear. I've been tying people up since before you were born."
"You don't have to do this. We're on the same side, Auntie," Zola protested. "I've been spying on your daughter and her minions even before they shut down the castle."
Lucretia stared at her.
"She?"
Lucretia looked down at the body that her mind currently occupied. "My daughter has shut down Castle Heterodyne?" Zola blinked.
"You couldn't tell?"
Lucretia waved a hand at the cavern walls.
"Not from down here, darling. This little retreat was so perfect because that interfering castle wasn't even aware it was here."
She gnawed gently at her lower lip.
"Dead? Well, that changes a few things."
Zola tried again.
"Auntie, I was going to help you."
Lucretia raised an eyebrow and smiled wistfully.
"My, you are just like dear Demonica, aren't you?"
She twirled around and whisked a dust sheet off of a mid-sized machine that sat lifeless to one side.
"Well, don't worry, my dear. You are going to help me."
Zola looked at the device and flinched.
"Ah! That's some kind of beacon engine!"
Lucretia was a bit thrown by this. How did the girl know about the summoning engines? That would need to be answered, but later. For now, she tried to hide her confusion.
"Not exactly, darling. This is some of my earlier work. It produced some amusing results and was very helpful in developing my later, most useful devices. With a few simple adjustments, I think it will do very well for what I have in mind today."
So saying, she lifted a panel off the machine and began tinkering. Zola stared, and then, with a small shudder, looked aside. Trying to watch a spark at work was just asking for violent headaches and disturbing flashbacks. Lucretia blithely chatted on as she worked.
"You are obviously familiar with the plans of the Order's inner circle. That will save us all so much tedious exposition."
Lucretia looked at Zola expectantly, but the girl kept silent, eyes narrowed and averted. Lucretia sniffed and continued to tinker with the machine. Finally, she could stand the silence no more.
"Well, if you must know," she continued, "my poor, stupid admirers in the Grand Sycophantic Order of the Knights of Jupiter, or whatever nonsense they call their ridiculous secret society, were supposed to do little else but search for this girl, Agatha, my daughter. She was supposed to be the perfect receptacle for me, for my mind."
Lucretia slumped back against the bench and frowned.
"But now that I'm in the girl's body, no thanks to them, it appears that I might have made a mistake, depending on her."
Zola spoke slowly.
"I don't understand. A mistake? How? She was..."
Yes, my child. Prepared and conditioned, and maybe if those fools had found her 10 years ago, or if that Barry," she spat the name, "hadn't interfered by giving her that wretched locket."
Footnote. The locket under discussion was given to Agatha by her uncle, Barry Heterodyne, when she began to display signs she was about to break through, that is, transition into a full-blown spark. Whereas this was something to be expected, considering her lineage, Agatha began to do this at the unprecedented age of 5. The locket, in brief, acted as a governor on young Agatha's brain, effectively retarding its development. Every indication we have was that this was supposed to be a short-term fix. Unfortunately, Barry disappeared, and Agatha wore the locket non-stop until it was removed when she was 18 years old. At that point, a lot of the preliminary neurological processes of a spark's breakthrough had already begun, but had been allowed to develop incredibly slowly. As a result, Agatha did not so much break through as ease through. This goes a long way towards explaining her relative sanity, despite her otherwise worrying pedigree. End footnote. Lucretia turned with a glare, and Zola spied the locket shining amidst the clutter atop the workbench. Lucretia seemed to deflate slightly.
But maybe not.
She picked up a small mirror and stared into it.
Maybe she simply has too much of her father in her after all.
Zola was astonished to see a tear well up in one of her aunt's eyes.
This is all his fault, she whispered.
Lucrezia became aware of Zola's interest and slammed the mirror down hard enough to crack it.
The point is that, for whatever reason, Agatha is too strong. It has become too easy for her to seize control of this body and keep me from taking it back. I am not winning. And worse, she's learning things from me, reaching into my mind and pulling out my secrets. She knew to look for this place. She intuitively grasps the principles of my work.
She took a breath, and Zola dared to interject.
But that's not uncommon. Your own work, while magnificent in its own right, of course, is a recognizable extension of some of your father's theories. Many sparks within a family have a natural insight.
She flinched as Lucrezia's fists slammed down on the bench before her, punctuating her words.
Silence!
She shrieked.
This girl must die!
She glared, panting, at Zola, who wisely said nothing. After a moment, Lucrezia regained control of herself and straightened up. Zola was immediately reminded of a cat that had fallen off a table and was nonchalantly pretending this was exactly what it had wanted to do.
Ideally, Lucrezia muttered, I would just destroy this body now while I still have control.
Zola blinked.
That's ideally?
Lucrezia was obviously thinking about something else, but a part of her blithely chatted on.
Of course, now that my priestesses have my summoning engine working, all they need to do is call me into some other suitable vessels. I've managed to expand the operating parameters, so I should have ever so many more choices now. Destroying the part of me that's occupying this wretched girl won't destroy me at all, not even close. Redundancy allows one to be so much more relaxed about sacrificing individual iterations.
Footnote. Statements like this have helped convince behavioral psychologists that wherever the original Lucrezia was, she was either incredibly mad or no longer human. A large majority of those questioned opined for both. End footnote. She frowned.
But in this calling, I have gained valuable information. Killing this girl before I have had a chance to pass it on.
She shook her head and once again focused her full attention on Zola.
Luckily, I won't have to go through the whole summoning rigmarole with you, dear.
She smiled reassuringly and patted the machine's carapace.
That wouldn't help me at all in this situation. The new calling would have none of the knowledge I've gained in this body. No, instead, I can simply use this lovely old toy of mine to copy myself from this troublesome girl into you. Then I will kill her.
She smiled at Zola.
After that, I shall rendezvous with the Sturmhalten Hive, round up a few more suitable girls, and then give myself all the important information over tea. Yes, that sounds perfect. I think I'll have those little jam sandwiches. I've really missed them. No.
Zola's quiet but emphatic statement caused Lucrezia to laugh with delight. She regarded Zola with genuine amusement.
Oh, I do so love a truly defiant subject. They're so much fun. Oh, if only I had the time to do it right.
Zola kept talking.
It won't work, Auntie. If you try to force yourself into my brain, you'll suffer resoc tigzafa.
Lucrezia's hilarity cut off as if a switch had been thrown. Zola nodded.
That is what your Geisterdomen call mutual brain death, yes?
Lucrezia scowled.
I see you are very well informed, aren't you?
Zola nodded.
Yes, I am. All those years ago, when you sent the Geisterdomen here to build your machines and hunt for your daughter, Agatha, some of those priestesses began to question the divinity of the great goddess they served so blindly. They began to think, to ask questions, and to see you for the fraud you are.
Lucrezia's slap threatened to dislocate Zola's jaw.
Fraud?
Lucrezia's fury was palpable.
How dare you? You know nothing, nothing!
She reached overhead and brought down a headset encrusted with components, then slammed it down on Zola's head.
I shall simply blast your mind from your body and rebuild your neural pathways. You can't!
Zola screamed from under the helmet.
Just like you can't use the Geisterdomen! For pity's sake, listen to me!
Lucretia, a live, sparking cable in her hand, paused. Zola continued.
Mother found your law mistress Milvissel. She jumped at the chance to study such a high-ranking geister. She learned everything Milvissel knew. One of the things she learned was how to block you if you ever came back and tried to pull just this sort of nonsense. Even if you brainwashed me to the point where I wanted to sacrifice myself, I couldn't let you take me over.
She peered out at Lucretia.
And it would get very messy. Go on, test me. Run a blue phase engram alignment. I'll wait.
Zola could see Lucretia's fury rising. Now was her chance.
But I can let you ride along inside my head. I can tell you how to do the modifications that will let you get out of here if you'll stop menacing me long enough to actually listen.
Lucretia stared at her and then carefully put down the cable.
Good heavens, dear. You seriously did intend to help me? But why didn't you say so?
Zola simply glared at her. Lucretia shrugged.
Oh, I know. Working with family really can be infuriating. Fine. I'm listening.
Zola nearly sagged with relief.
About time. So, you want the Heterodyne girl dead? I am all for that. But unless you work with me, you'll lose everything you've learned here, including everything you've just learned from me about the family.
Lucretia slowly tapped her finger.
Do get to the point, dear.
Zola licked her lips.
Just what I said. I can let you in. You can share my mind.
Lucretia slapped the bench.
Share my power, you mean? I do see where this is going, you presumptuous little...
Precisely. I want to play too. Now, the Order has been very busy while you've been away. They have gone to a lot of trouble to set me in place as the lost Heterodyne heir. Their plan has gone wrong in every possible way, but it has its good points. Together, we can still make it work.
Lucretia growled.
Those fools in the Order with their stupid, short-sighted plans. I knew I should have killed half of them years ago. The difficulty was in deciding which half.
Zola felt a flash of sympathy.
Fools, yes, but most of them are still loyal to you.
Oh, lucky, lucky me.
But the family?
Lucretia smiled.
Oh, hush, dear. I already know everyone is plotting against me. But purely by accident, you might have a valid argument.
As she said this, Lucretia removed the helmet, then wheeled over an alarming-looking device that consisted primarily of a number of loaded syringes, which were all aiming at Zola's head. Lucretia picked up a switchbox, and the device lit up and flexed slightly. A drop of solution fell next to Zola's hand, and a wisp of acrid smoke puffed upwards. Lucretia studied a small screen.
Now lie to me, just for calibration purposes, darling. Are you male?
Yes.
Lucretia nodded.
Good enough.
Zola jerked in her seat.
What? No, it isn't. To properly calibrate...
Boring! Lucretia sang out. Just stick to the truth, darling. It's usually easier to remember anyway.
Zola stared back at her.
Is Klaus Wulfenbach really the ruler of Europa?
The Baron? Yes, yes, he is.
And everyone accepts this?
Zola stared fixedly at the needles above her.
The 50 families don't like it, but no one can resist him.
Lucretia sighed nostalgically.
I can believe that. And his empire, it's stable?
Zola paused.
He's done nothing but expand it for the last 16 years. He's never had to deal with the problems of stability, per se.
Lucretia sighed.
That impossible man. He's too good a piece to lose.
She nudged the syringe rack away with a foot.
All right, my dear. Lucky for you, I simply must stay. We have a bargain.
Zola allowed herself to relax back against the chair. She heard Lucretia humming to herself as she began fiddling with a device on one of the workbenches. She frowned.
Auntie, aren't you going to release me?
All in due time, darling.
Several minutes later, Lucretia swept over, lugging a complicated device that trailed several wiry cables behind her. She hooked it to the helmet and once again placed it on Zola's head.
There we go, she said cheerfully. Now, obviously, I've had to make a few modifications, but this old equipment should prove quite adequate.
When she was satisfied, she placed another helmet on her own head and hooked up several more wires. Several lights came on, and she nodded in satisfaction. Zola spoke up. sarcasm thick in her voice.
Is there anything you need me to do?
Lucretia considered this and flipped a knife switch. Instantly, a surge of power ripped through both women, causing Zola to gasp and driving Lucretia to her knees. As abruptly as it began, the power cut off. Lucretia took a deep breath and lifted the helmet from her head.
Try not to pass out?
The girl in the chair stirred, and her eyes flicked open.
Ooh,
said Lucretia from Zola's own mouth, with Zola's own voice.
This does feel different.
The first Lucretia leaned over and gently tapped her forehead with Agatha's finger.
And is our dear little niece still in there?
Yes, she's here.
Lucretia Zola frowned.
It's a bit odd. This head feels wrong.
Lucretia Agatha giggled as she began releasing the chair's restraints.
Hardly surprising, dear. It is wrong. Whatever else I will say about my daughter Agatha, she is a very comfortable fit.
Lucretia Zola levered herself out of her chair and stretched. She frowned.
Oh, I'm getting some of her surface thoughts.
She looked pensive.
She's gloating?
Suddenly, Zola froze. Her eyes widened with astonished admiration.
Good heavens, Auntie! You got a baron with a slaver wasp?
The Lucretia within Agatha rocked back.
What? How?
Zola's eyes opened even wider.
Ooh, and that's why no one's ever been able to find the Citadel of Silver Light. Amazing! Oh, it explains so much.
Get out of those memories, Lucretia screamed. Lucretia, darling, are you even still in there? Fight her off!
Zola shrugged.
Oh, she's trying, but she can't.
Lucretia rushed forward, a heavy wrench held high, but Zola pivoted smoothly and drove a foot into Lucretia's midriff.
The family has had years to prepare for your inevitable reappearance, and Lord Mistress Milvissel was ever so much help.
She smirked down at the gasping Lucretia and tapped her forehead.
My copy of you is now safely ensnared in a neural trap, where I can sift through your precious secrets at my leisure.
Lucretia snarled in outrage.
You said you wanted to help me!
Zola looked contrite.
That's true.
Her expression changed to one of hurt surprise.
And yet, oh dear, I see that you planned to vivisect me the minute you got your information back to your other selves. Oh, Auntie, really?
Lucretia screamed with rage and tried to climb to her feet. Zola casually swept them out from under her.
Don't worry, darling. I'll keep my end of the bargain. A version of you will make it out of here. Your plans will go ahead beautifully, and no one, not even your other selves, will ever suspect that I'm the one in control.
She smiled sweetly and drew her pistol.
Now, as we agreed, it's time for Agatha Heterodyne to die. Then I can take my time with those three fools you so conveniently locked up for me.
A peculiar look crossed Zola's face.
Wait, I'm getting...
She looked at Lucretia blankly.
You only found two. No, there were three. Violetta and Gil.
Her eyes widened.
That means you missed...
She jerked back in surprise, which is why when Tarvek dropped from where he'd been hiding in the rafters, the cudgel he swung viciously at her head only cracked firmly across her wrist. Zola's pistol spun away as she shrieked in pain and surprise. Tarvek was about to finish her off when he saw from the corner of his eye Lucretia diving for the pistol. Without hesitation, he swung his foot against her jaw, sending her crashing into a bank of machinery.
Tarvek! Lucretia cried. Don't be a fool! Aid me! I am the Agatha girl!
Tarvek rolled his eyes even as he dived for the gun. A jar of desiccated leeches shattered against his side, and his hand missed the pistol by scant centimeters. Zola followed.
Don't listen to her, Prince Sternvorus! She's the other! We have to stop her!
A small machine smashed into Zola's forehead, stopping her dead in place. Lucretia followed, doing a full-body dive for the gun.
If I die, your precious Agatha dies too. You dare not work against me.
A wheeled tea cart caught her full in the face and dropped her to the floor. The three rose to their feet simultaneously and realized they were all equidistant from the pistol. There was a tense moment where they all appraised each other, and then all moved at once. Tarvek leapt towards the gun and was astonished when he reached it unimpeded. He rolled to his knees, pistol in one hand and cudgel in the other, to find himself alone. A clacking sound caused him to spin in time to see Zola snapping shut a large machine rifle of some sort, a triumphant grin on her bruised face. An amused ahem drew both of their gazes to the other side of the room, where Lucretia stood smiling. When she saw they were both focused on her, she flipped a delicate switch. Instantly, the doors slammed shut, and a series of red lights began blinking. A scratchy, recorded voice drifted down from the ceiling.
"Hello, intruders. The blast doors are now sealed, and my laboratory's self-destruct mechanism has been engaged. Shouldn't have snooped, darlings, but it's too late now. You're going to die horribly in 60. 59.
"What are you doing?" Tarvek demanded. "Stop it! You'll die too!"
Lucretia threw her head back and laughed.
"No power on Earth can stop my perfect death trap. This iteration's death is unfortunate, but the two of you are so annoying that I consider it worth it."
Zola's lip curled.
"No, I don't think so."
In a single smooth movement, she drew, pointed, and shot a high-pressure grappling gun upwards into the ragged shaft in the ceiling. From high above came the solid thunk of the hook. Lucretia and Tarvek, after a momentary surprise, dashed towards her, but Zola engaged the winch, and with a laugh, she was pulled up and out of their reach.
"Later, Tarvek," she sang out. "Or maybe not. Bye, Auntie. I'll be sure to say hello to your other selves. Hee hee hee."
And still giggling, she vanished from sight. The two stared upwards. Tarvek looked at Lucretia.
"If she's got that big gun, why didn't she just shoot us?"
Lucretia considered this.
"Well, it only shoots marshmallows, so the real question is, why did she bother taking it at all?"
Tarvek sneered.
"Oh, by the way, nice death trap."
Lucretia looked embarrassed.
"That hole in the ceiling was not part of the original design. You're not supposed to get in by tunneling straight down."
Tarvek conceded this and peered up again.
"Well, Agatha, myself, and the others came in that way. Perhaps we can..."
A flash of light was followed by a hollow boom.
"Blue fire!" Tarvek yelled. "She's blown the shaft!"
Instinctively, he tackled Lucretia, pulling her with him as he dived for cover.
"Run!"
The room shook as a small avalanche of rock crashed to the ground. A torrent of dust and smoke poured from the shaft and filled the air, spreading like a wave. Tarvek landed with Lucretia in his arms, sheltered by a row of huge glass tubes. The avalanche of material flowed around them, demolishing and covering machines and furniture before grinding to a halt. Then there was silence. For a moment, they huddled, breathing deeply. Tarvek buried his face in Agatha's hair and closed his eyes. Her hair was still soft, but smelled of oil and electricity mixed with stale sweat and dust. None of them had been able to wash for quite some time, and he knew he was in a similar state. Agatha was safe, and somehow that knowledge made her smell wonderful. He pulled back slightly to gaze into her eyes, and met Lucretia's smirk as she batted her eyelashes up at him. In his panic, he had only thought of keeping Agatha safe, momentarily forgetting Lucretia was within her. He jolted back in revulsion.
"You!"
he snarled. His startled movement made it easy for Lucretia to slam him back even farther so that he toppled and fell through the open hatch of one of the tubes. He swung up in time to see Lucretia shut and bolt the tube's door, sealing him in.
"Me,"
she crowed. It was then they both remembered the self-destruct mechanism. Its patient, automated voice had continued to count down the seconds. Lucretia looked tired. She glanced over at Tarvek.
"Really, it would be so much easier to just kill everyone here and start over with a new calling. I could see sacrificing all the other knowledge I've gained, but I mustn't allow myself to forget that one of me has been captured by that traitorous niece of mine. She is simply too dangerous."
She sighed and gingerly picked her way through the rubble to the control panel.
"No, I'm afraid this body must continue to live for now."
So saying, she flipped a switch, and the voice stopped in mid-sentence.
"You said no power on Earth could stop that,"
Tarvek protested, his voice muffled through the thick glass of his prison. Lucretia nodded.
"I did, didn't I?"
She turned to face him, and a look of pleased surprise was on her face.
It looks like we've learned something else useful, hmm? Little Zola should have known how to turn off my self-destruct system.
Tarvek nodded. Lucretia was poisonous, and he hated her, but he was always reluctantly fascinated when she talked about her work.
Perhaps if Zola had time to concentrate, perhaps your copy is able to hold some things back in the heat of the moment.
Or can confuse her with false memories.
Lucretia clapped her hands.
That is what I would do. Little Zola may not find my memories as useful as she thinks they will be.
This cheered her up considerably, and she began humming as she cleared debris away from the tubes. Tarvek hammered at the door, which didn't even rattle. Earlier, he had seen Lucretia place his comrades, Gilgamesh and Violetta, in the adjacent tubes, and they were still there, slumped and unconscious.
This may work out nicely after all, Lucretia mused as she worked.
She patted the glass on Tarvek's tube as she passed.
Oh, don't worry, I'm not going to kill you. That wouldn't be fun at all.
She sashayed over to a control box and flipped a switch. Lights slowly glimmered into existence.
Now, these old mind control devices of mine were an early effort. My beautiful wasps are ever so much easier to administer, but since you're already there, they'll do quite nicely.
She gazed at the row of tubes and unconsciously licked her lips.
To have Baron Wulfenbach's son Gilgamesh and you, the nascent Storm King, under my control?
She gazed down at herself and smiled.
The possibilities make me quite giddy.
Lucretia began to chuckle, which turned into an angry squeal of surprise as she was yanked to the ground. Lucretia struggled but found her ankle trapped in a grip of iron. The battered face of the vicious construct Von Pin glared at her with furious eyes.
What the deuce are you doing? Lucretia screamed. You're supposed to be dead!
Von Pin grinned, a wide, nasty grin full of sharp teeth. She slowly began to drag her broken body forward across Lucretia's legs.
Not quite, she whispered.
Release me this instant, Lucretia said imperiously. That's an order!
Von Pin hissed in amusement. The leather encasing her body creaked as she advanced.
That will no longer work, you filthy thief of souls. It was not easy, but I have found ways to break your hold on me.
Lucretia's efforts to escape took on a new urgency.
Ridiculous! You cannot resist me! I made sure of that when I built you! Stop, I say!
Von Pin's metal claws hooked into Lucretia's belt, and the construct pulled herself higher.
Ah, you built this cage, but you did not build me. Have you forgotten your greatest triumph? Even trapped in this miserable flesh, I am Otilia, the Muse of Protection.
Lucretia opened her mouth, and a hand of steel and leather closed on her throat. Her eyes bulged in terror.
No,
Lucretia choked out.
Can't die. Too important.
Von Pin's face drew close. She glared into Lucretia's eyes. Her terrible jaws snapped together in a fearsome grimace.
Then run,
she snarled. Lucretia shuddered once. Her eyes began to lose focus and close.
Curse you,
she whispered.
I'll be back.
She retreated. Agatha opened her eyes and gave a strangled choke of surprise.
What? Von Pin, stop!
With a smirk, Von Pin released her grip and collapsed fully atop Agatha.
What was that all about?
Agatha asked as she struggled to extricate herself.
Your mother was always a coward,
Von Pin said dreamily.
She could never tolerate pain. You should remember that.
Her voice trailed off as she slipped into unconsciousness. Moloch von Zinzer sat brooding. Ordinarily, he would be assisting the Sparks in refurbishing the great cat-like security clank that lay stretched out on the floor. Today, however, with four different Sparks crowding around the clank, arguing, jostling, and attempting to work on it all at the same time, he merely watched from a safe distance, perched on a crate that had been pushed to one side of the room. Beside him sat Fräulein Hexalina Snaug, Dr. Middleman's minion. They were sharing a small sack of raisins. Snaug was observing Moloch closely. The little mechanic had undergone a radical transformation in the last day or so. Ever since he had been sentenced to work in Castle Heterodyne, Moloch had earned a reputation as a clueless screw-up. The general consensus was that the only reason he was still alive was because no newer prisoners had arrived to take his place in the castle kitchens. But that had changed ever since the Heterodyne had appeared. Something about her presence had shaken him so badly that he had undergone a startling transformation. He started handling other minions, sparks, and the castle itself with an artless efficiency that was the envy of the other minions and had even been noted by some of the other sparks. Thus it was with some surprise and no little embarrassment that Hexalina found herself entertaining certain fantasies that had her blushing. Moloch heard a faint sigh and glanced over at her. A touch of concern appeared on his face as the girl beside him appeared slightly flushed.
You okay?
Snaug nodded.
Just worried about...
She waved her hand to encompass everything in sight. Moloch nodded.
What are you thinking so deeply about?
The castle. Didn't I once hear Professor Tichtofen say that it was alive?
Snaug nodded.
It's a point of some contention amongst those sparks who dabble in artificial intelligence, but Tichtofen said the castle, that is, not the walls exactly, but the part that's, well, dead now, I guess.
She threw out her chest and waved her arms about.
Exhibits many of the prerequisites that would allow us to classify it as an intelligent entity.
Moloch snorted at the accuracy of the imitation. Footnote. Many minions have developed the knack of imitating various sparks. It only becomes a problem when somebody gets interested in the whole mind-swapping thing. It's one of the reasons why, by common consent, this is a field of science that is never pursued. Or if it is, it stays between consenting adults. End footnote.
No, I don't mean smart. That's obvious. I mean alive. Like you or a construct.
Hexalina paused.
Oh, I see. Well, that's what Tichtofen believes. He claimed it was an entirely new form of life. Why?
Moloch slapped a stone. It shifted slightly.
Because when you kill something, it usually starts to rot.
The two of them absorbed the implications of this, then hurried to the sparks to offer assistance. Unfortunately, not a lot of constructive work was getting done around the mechanical cat. One of the sparks, Theophilus Dumed, happened to glance down in time to see a small clank dragging off the micrometer he'd been using. His yell caused a modest swarm of similar small clanks to flee, all clutching tools and equipment. Theo chased them until they disappeared into a large crack in the wall, dragging their spoils behind them. With an oath, he flung his work gloves to the ground. His fury doubled when another tiny clank popped out, grabbed the gloves, and dragged them out of sight as well.
This is not going well at all, he snarled. Those confounded little clanks of Agatha's have gone out of control. They steal parts, tools. When we repair something on this beast, they nip in and rip out something else.
He gave the clank a kick.
We'll never get this thing moving at this rate.
Moloch nodded and began checking the hoist controls on the makeshift lift. He stared down into the hole Agatha had blasted in the floor of the castle and gave a resigned sigh.
Guess I'd better go get Spooky Girl and Wulfenbach and let them—
No!
Professor Caractacus Metzasalma drew himself up on his mechanical legs and glared.
We do not need to run to a Wulfenbach every time we have a problem. We are sparks. We can solve this.
The others nodded in agreement.
It may take years, endless toil, the blood of thousands of minions, but our science will triumph.
The other sparks cheered. Moloch rolled his eyes. Princess Zetha and Airman Axel Higgs regarded the cavorting sparks from a safe distance on the other side of the room. They shared a significant glance. Zetha nodded and pulled a small mechanism from her pocket.
Okay, I think it's time for this.
Higgs leaned in to examine it. It was a small, decorated metal sphere.
What is it?
Don't know, Zetha admitted as she hit the only switch. But Agatha said it would help, and really, at this point, how much more trouble could it be?
The sphere shivered. Small panels slid aside, releasing a set of arms and legs that unfolded with a snap. A mismatched pair of eyes swiveled open and examined the room. It turned back to Zetha,
nodded once, and leapt to the ground and scuttled away. Higgs cocked an eyebrow.
I guess we'll find out.
The walls of Castle Heterodyne contain unusual spaces, places where corners come together in odd ways, secret places sealed away for forgotten reasons, and, of course, places where the mechanisms that allow the castle to perform its many wonders are housed. In the castle walls, two separate teams of dingbots, each led by a small commander, were busy assembling devices intended to crush their opposite number. Each of these primaries was fiercely terrestrial and regarded the presence of the other primary as a direct challenge to their control. Footnote: the diminutive clanks, now colloquially known as dingbots, were constructed by Lady Heterodyne as lab assistants and were fascinating entities. The ones the Lady constructed herself served as primaries. Once activated, they operated independently, scavenging parts and constructing additional, secondary dingbots. These would then go forth to construct tertiaries. Persons of a nervous disposition have allowed themselves to become overly concerned about a future where all of Europa is buried hip-deep in duodenary dingbots busy disassembling the Earth itself for parts. Fortunately, secondaries were not as good at building dingbots as the primaries are, and the tertiaries were barely capable of performing simple tasks, let alone constructing more dingbots. End footnote. They marched among their troops, clicking and whistling with smug self-importance. An unearthly music unexpectedly began in the room outside. Both teams of little clanks froze. Dreamily, they dropped tools and began to move towards the sound. They thronged into the room and gathered around the hulk of the security clank, waiting. The sparks who had been rebuilding it danced backward, trying their best not to trip over the single-minded tide of clanks. Standing atop the security clank was the music's source, the little round clank that Zetha had activated. The rest stared up at it, mesmerized. The two primaries pushed their way through the group until they stood at the front, gazing upwards in evident astonishment. The music ended, and the singer gazed down on the assembled crowd. The two primaries blinked. Then each understood, with fury, that it was standing next to its hated rival. They moved to fight, but the round clank rang out a single clear tone, and both primaries dropped to their knees. Atop the new clank, a small hatch folded open with a crisp snap and revealed a minuscule crown. The assembled clanks stood frozen before their new ruler. It clapped its jewel-like hands once, and without a word, the clank armies became one. Surging forward, they overran the giant security clank like ants on a hill. Everyone stared at this flurry of activity in amazement. Theo leaned back and nodded in approval.
"They're repairing it," he said. "This looks promising."
Dr. Middlemint gripped his arm.
"A promising disaster," he growled. "Can you not see it?"
Theo blinked.
No.
Middlemint indicated the organized chaos swirling before them.
"Observe! Those little clanks are building, designing."
Diaz's eyes widened.
"Spitting in the face of the Creator."
Metzasalma gasped.
"Warping science."
They all looked expectantly at Theo, who felt like he was letting down the home team. He shrugged.
"So?"
Middleman smacked the back of his head.
"They are taking our jobs. We are doomed,"
Diaz declared. Metzasalma concurred.
"Doomed!"
Theo rolled his eyes.
"Nonsense. These things are but tools."
He scooped up a clank that had been attempting to straighten a steel strut with only a tiny hammer. He tried not to notice it seemed to be succeeding.
"New, complex tools, certainly, but surely there are unique strengths that we, as men of science, can provide that these little mechanisms cannot."
The three sparks looked abashed. Metzasalma rubbed his jaw.
"Oh, well, certainly."
The others nodded and looked like they might relax when Moloch, who had been deep in conversation with Snaug, wandered up and took notice of what was happening.
"Oh, not these things again,"
he groaned.
"They start by being helpful, but soon they'll build something terrible that could kill us all."
The three older sparks went white.
"Doomed!"
they moaned. Suddenly there was a shudder and a prolonged rumble. A huge billow of smoke and dust erupted from the shaft now opening in the floor. When the room stopped shaking, they all crowded around the edge and peered downwards. Higgs lit a torch, dropped it, they were able to follow it even through the dust, and saw it bounce and land on a heap of rubble almost 100 meters down.
That happened faster than I thought it would,
Moloch muttered to himself. Diaz shook his head.
I do not know what you were expecting, but that was an explosion from a bomb. Someone did this deliberately.
Zetha looked stricken. Agatha, she whispered.
Airman Higgs carefully put his pipe in his pocket.
Master Gilgamesh is down there, too. Guess we'd better go see if they're all right.
Moloch raised an eyebrow.
You ain't going this way.
Higgs nodded.
Lady Heterodyne carved this hole. There are other paths. Well, sure, but where are they?
Higgs paused and realized that everyone was looking at him.
I think I can get there.
Moloch looked skeptical. Higgs hesitated, then continued.
I found a map.
A map?
Professor Diaz perked up.
That could be useful indeed. Where is it?
The airman shrugged.
It's down in the lab.
Diaz frowned.
That does not do us much good, then.
Higgs tapped the side of his head.
I remember maps.
The professor opened his mouth, but Higgs continued.
Who's coming with me?
Zetha stepped up.
I am.
A tiny smile scurried across Higgs' face.
Good.
Zetha felt inordinately pleased at this reaction. She tried to hide it by looking to Crosp.
How about you?
Of course, the cat responded. Agatha'll be lost without me.
Higgs turned towards Moloch.
What about you?
Moloch looked alarmed.
Why me? You're useful.
Higgs slid a glance toward the huge security clank and the little clank army that swarmed it, working furiously.
Don't think you're needed here. Of course, the mad boys could probably think of something to do to you.
Moloch clapped his hands.
Let's go.
Theo Demed and Slepnir O'Hara, friends of Gil who had helped him gain entrance to the castle, were standing to the side, watching. Slepnir leaned in towards Theo.
A map?
Her voice was the barest whisper, practiced during countless pranks and adventures back on Castle Wulfenbach.
Of this place? That doesn't even...
Theo answered with a matching whisper.
I know, but he says he can get us back to Gil and Agatha.
He narrowed his eyes as he studied the airman.
If he's got a claim there's a map in order to do it, fine, he found a map.
He raised his voice to call.
We'll come too.
Zetha nodded.
Yeah, you can handle the spark stuff.
She turned to Professor Metzasalma.
Can the rest of you get this thing running?
The professor gave an offended snort.
Of course.
He then paused.
If those wind-up mice will let us.
Zetha nodded, then strode up and confronted the Queen Clank.
Hey, Agatha needs this cat monster thing up and running as soon as possible. Help these guys make that happen, got it?
The diminutive ruler reared up, clearly offended. It then considered the warrior princess who stood before it and gave a clear nod of acquiescence. Zetha turned, caught sight of Metzasalma's smirk of triumph, and buttonholed him before he could move.
And I'll be checking to make sure that's all you had them do, so no bright ideas. No extras, no deviation from what's already here. I know how sparks think.
The professor looked into her pitiless eyes and swallowed.
That's quite a reasonable demand, considering the circumstances.
He swiveled his eyes back.
Don't you agree, my dear fellows?
Both Diaz and Middleman looked like they were sucking on persimmons, but they gave stiff nods nonetheless. Fortunately, Dr. Middleman's natural ebullience could not be contained for long, and with a sigh, he shrugged and declared,
To work, everyone!
He leaned towards Fräulein Snaug.
Prepare a list!
Hexalina shuffled her feet.
Actually, Herr Doctor, I'd like to go help find the Lady Heterodyne.
Her master turned towards her, astonishment writ large upon his face. She continued,
Please, sir?
Middleman glanced over at the security clank and its busy repair team. It was a fascinating sight.
But why?
Moloch stepped up to her and touched her shoulder.
Hey, are you coming? I'd feel better having someone at my back who wasn't completely nuts.
Snaug glanced at Middleman.
Maybe, in a minute.
The mechanic nodded, grabbed a toolbox, and legged it back to the group assembling around Airman Higgs. Snaug watched him go, a look of longing on her face. The doctor observed this, and a knowing smile softened his features. Fräulein Snaug looked back up at him hopefully.
Ah, yes, of course.
Mittelmund awkwardly patted her head.
Off you go, girl.
He then snapped out a hand and prevented her from darting off. Once he had her attention, he raised an admonishing finger.
But no permanent damage. He belongs to the lady now.
A quick pout crossed Hexalina's face, and her hands clenched in frustration, but Mittelmund was adamant. She gave a small huff and nodded.
Yes, doctor.
Mittelmund smiled and released her. Snaug caught sight of Moloch and repressed a small thrill of anticipation. Permanent was such a delightfully high bar. Violetta closed the fastening with a satisfying snap.
There!
Everyone gave a sigh of relief. Once Lucretia had retreated, Agatha had scooped up her locket, holding it close to her with one hand, as with her other hand she rushed to release the others from their glass prisons. Zola had damaged the necklace when she yanked it away, so Violetta repaired the clasp while Agatha held it in place. Now the locket was once again firmly held at Agatha's throat.
Thank you, Violetta.
Agatha gave it an experimental tug and frowned.
Maybe I'd better just weld the thing onto an iron ring.
Violetta rolled her eyes.
Don't be overly dramatic. A good solid lock will work fine.
She cast a scornful eye towards Gil and Tarvek, who were busy seeing to Von Pin.
Whose adolescent slave girl fantasies are we indulging here?
Agatha quickly changed the subject as they joined Gil and Tarvek beside one of the lab's operating tables.
How is Madame Von Pin doing?
I'm amazed she's still alive, actually,
Tarvek confessed. Gil shrugged.
Constructs of this type are notoriously tough, and we've managed to stabilize her for now.
Tarvek shook his head.
But her body is definitely on its way out.
He began ticking items off on his fingers.
We need to extract the castle entity from the body of the muse, Otilia. Then we need to transfer Otilia's mind out of the body we know as Von Pin and into a suitable clank body until the muse can be repaired. Then we have to transfer the castle entity back into the castle system.
Gil nodded.
It's like a sliding puzzle in that we can't do anything until we do the first step, and we can't do that until the others get back with that watchdog clank.
No.
They turned at the firmness in Agatha's voice.
We can't wait. We have to leave as soon as we can.
Agatha strode over to a bench and grabbed a brass tube and began stringing wires through it.
Zola now has access to all of my mother's, Lucretia's, memories, right?
Tarvek waggled his hand.
Yes, for the most part.
Agatha turned to Gil.
And your father is probably still planning on destroying the castle.
Gil nodded.
I'm sort of counting on him not doing so while I'm inside, but yes.
Agatha selected a coil of copper tubing, snipped off a length, and began bending it into a fanciful hook.
That's two very powerful enemies, one inside the castle and the other outside.
She laced wiring about the base of the coil and began attaching it to the tube.
Nobody here.
The wave of her hand indicated the room, the castle, and probably Mechanicsburg as a whole.
Is safe until I get the castle running again.
She glanced down at the construct on the slab.
That includes Madame Von Pin here.
She stared intently at a small electronic device that was sitting on the bench before her. She selected a large monkey wrench and, with a fluid movement, smashed the device sharply and precisely, causing the case to disintegrate without damaging the components inside. With a satisfied nod, she picked them up and began inserting them into the end of the brass tube.
We'll have to leave notes for the others. They're smart, and Theo and Sleipnir care about Von Pin too, I imagine. Once they find their way back here, they should be able to get started on her without us.
Agatha turned to face them. Idly, she swung the copper and brass wand through the air, testing its weight.
Our first priority is repairing the castle.
She pointed to a small collection of equipment piled up on a bench.
I've gathered what I think I'll need to transfer the part of its consciousness that's in Otilia's body back into its main system.
She looked over to the shattered hulk of the muse.
That's assuming we can find a place to hook you up.
The clank jerked its head up.
I can show guide you, but even with the four of you, you have too much equipment. I am too large and heavy. To transport this me alone will require...
As the muse was talking, Agatha snapped a switch on the wand. It sparked to life, and a crackling bolt of energy burned between the points of the hook. With a deft swing, Agatha sliced the muse's head cleanly off and caught it before it hit the ground. She turned to the others.
I have that covered. Any other problems?
In the shocked silence, there was a burst of static, and then the head tucked underneath her arm spoke.
No, we are good.
The great flying armada that accompanied Castle Wulfenbach was slowly regrouping. Mechanicsburg's newly reactivated torchman clanks had driven it away like a swarm of bees fighting off an invasion of wasps. It now hovered 2.5 leagues to the north of the town as it saw to its reorganization and repair. A footnote, after some experimentation, it was determined that the defense system of Mechanicsburg defines a league as 5.556 kilometers. End footnote. A squadron of damaged ships flashed a departure signal, then peeled off towards the already overtaxed repair yards at Sturmhalten. Other ships were covered with swarms of rigger rats, busy replacing canvas or repairing hulls, even as they hung at dizzying heights above the ground. Aboard one small, unobtrusive vessel, an inner door burst open. The occupants of the room, who had been examining a large map of the town and its surroundings, leaped in surprise. One produced a knife, seemingly from thin air. In the doorway stood Boris Dolokhov, second in command to Baron Wulfenbach and the man currently running the empire of the Pax Transylvania while its master recuperated in hospital. Boris had a reputation as being perennially annoyed, but the man who stood framed in the doorway now radiated a controlled fury that had those who saw him, seasoned fighters all, slowly rising to their feet and flexing their claws. Boris's normally fastidious appearance was marred by several bruises on his face, and one of his four arms hung limp. His suit was tattered and looked as though he had been in a fight. Several fights. General Kurjan, who was easily the most level-headed of the three Jägermonster generals, gave him a wary nod.
Gospodin Dolokhov, how did you find us?
Boris removed a handkerchief from an inner pocket and delicately dabbed it at his lip.
Your messenger told me.
The three generals glanced at each other. Kurjan raised his chin defensively.
He would not.
The Baron had been declared hors du combat, and Boris was in the process of coordinating the current situation vis-à-vis Mechanicsburg. There had been a sudden disruption at the door, and a Jägermonster officer had sauntered in.
Hey there, Mr. Boris Bogman.
Boris swore under his breath. Then a sudden realization made him frown.
Wait a minute.
The Jägers had been created by the Heterodynes. Because of this, the news of Agatha's existence had been carefully kept from them. In advance of the Empire's sally into this neighborhood, every Jägermonster that served the Empire had been plausibly dispatched to far-flung locations. He flipped through a stack of troop movement reports.
What are you even doing here? All of you Jägers are supposed to be up north.
The Jäger carefully collected a stack of paperwork, then sat on it.
Yes, well, sweetheart, we got a message for you.
He smiled at Boris.
We quit.
Boris carefully adjusted his pince-nez.
I don't have time for jokes.
The Jäger shrugged insouciantly.
No jokes, sport, is a message direct from the generals.
Obviously, I need to talk to them. Where are they?
The Jäger laughed uproariously.
Well, they ain't got time to waste talking to you.
He unwound himself from his chair and leaned over to gently pat Boris's cheek.
Is you disappointed we ain't gonna be around anymore?
He smiled toothily.
Tell you what, I let you get one punch in to treasure in your old age.
He then cracked his knuckles.
Or when you wakes up.
Without breaking eye contact, Boris dragged his fourth arm into view. Grasped firmly in his hand was a severely beaten and battered Jäger, whom he allowed to drop with a thud to the deck.
Oh,
he allowed.
Not right away.
The generals stared down in shock until Zog, the oldest, threw his head back with a roar of delighted laughter. He tossed the knife in his hands upwards with a flourish, and it performed a delicate pirouette before sliding cleanly into the scabbard at his hip.
You has earned the right to a talk.
He turned to the astonished Curjan and smacked him on the arm.
Alexei, get some tea for our guest.
He reached back and spun a chair into place at their table.
The talk.
As the injured Jaeger was taken away, Boris nodded, took a seat, and fastidiously adjusted his cuffs. A tall glass of tea was quietly set down before him. Zog sat opposite and studied him openly. In his opinion, Boris was under a great deal of stress, more so than usual. The man did periodically take over the reins of the Baron's empire without trouble, but these were unquestionably extraordinary times. Boris took a deep breath in through his nose.
You say you are leaving the Baron's service.
Zog nodded.
There is a Heterodyne. That was the contingency. She is not official. She has not taken the castle. The doom bell has not rung.
Zog ground his teeth together in annoyance.
Pfft. Technicalities. Anyway, we have not entered the town, yeah?
Boris rolled his eyes.
You mean your troops haven't climbed up a set of stairs?
Zog was unpleasantly surprised.
Oh-ho!
He blustered.
What you—
He was interrupted by Boris slamming two of his hands on the table.
No, 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 no. We cannot fight. Not now.
He looked at the other generals.
We need you. The Empire needs you.
Zog waved a hand dismissively.
The Baron has got lots of troops. Thousands.
He smiled.
Some of them might even give us a good fight.
To his disappointment, Boris did not rise to the bait, but nodded seriously instead.
Granted, but everyone knows that the Jaegers serve the House of Heterodyne. If you acknowledge this girl prematurely, it could fuel trouble all over Europa.
Zog shrugged and scratched at his chin.
Yeah, that's true. Could be we's in for good times. Lots of fighting, lots of fun.
Boris folded his arms.
Oh, really? And how will your new Heterodyne like that sort of chaos, if she takes after her father and uncle?
Zog looked like he had bitten into a particularly bitter bug. He glanced at his compatriots. General Goomblast considered this.
Her papa?
He wiggled a hand to indicate that it was an open question. Then he sighed.
But she does seem more like her uncle than her papa, yeah?
The others nodded. General Curjan cleared his throat and tried to look reasonable.
You said prematurely?
Boris took a sip of tea.
I did.
He looked at the three old generals.
Wait. Wait until she takes the castle. Wait until the doom bell rings. Wait until the Baron formally releases you back into her service.
He spread his hands.
Let the people of Europa see that the law of the Wulfenbach Empire still holds.
Zog frowned.
And let the people see that the Heterodyne submits to those laws, hey?
Goomblast clicked his claws together.
Brothers, Mr. Boris makes a good point.
Zog's fur bristled.
Empire law.
Curjan leaned in.
Don't always think of yourself, Zog. This way, Miss Agatha can choose her first war.
Zog's eyebrows shot up, and he looked at his fellow general with new respect.
Oh, that is very true, Alexei.
He leaned into Boris and explained.
A girl has got to be picky about her first war.
He glanced back at the other generals.
Remember the Lady Roxalana?
To Boris's astonishment, he saw the other two generals blushing. He opened his mouth to ask, then realized he really did not want to know. Footnote. Intriguingly, there is no written record of a Roxalana Heterodyne. However, in a 100-kilometer radius around the town of Mechanicsburg, one will find assorted geographic features clearly caused by the unleashing of cataclysmic forces. These include Roxalana's chasm, Roxalana's blight, the melted mountain of Roxalana, and a vast wasteland where nothing grows, known as Roxalana's comeuppance. End footnote. As Zog chuckled, Goomblast stepped up and made a formal bow.
Okay, Mr. Boris. Maybe we do this your way.
Boris let out a sigh of relief.
Excellent.
Goomblast held up a delicate finger.
If you agrees to certain trade concessions we is gonna discuss now.
Sweat broke out on Boris's forehead. Still, it could have been a lot worse. A voice rang out from behind the group.
Sirs, if you agree to this, the Lady Heterodyne will die.
Everyone spun around to see a tall, jaunty man sitting in the window. Boris started to his feet, unwelcome recognition obviously showing on his face. The man in the window continued.
Do forgive me for letting myself in, generals. I am Ardsley Wooster. You might recognize me as Gilgamesh Wulfenbach's manservant, but in actuality, I am an agent of British intelligence.
General Goomblast impatiently waved a hand.
Yes, yes, everybody knew that. Now what was that about the Lady Heterodyne?
Wooster sighed. Apparently his secret had been safe, with everyone. Oh well.
I regret to say that Herr Dolokhov is not playing straight with you.
Boris gave a desperate shout and tried to leap forward, but was easily kept in check by one of Curzon's large hands.
Keep talking, Herr Wooster.
Wooster nodded.
What he isn't telling you is that if you stand by and do nothing, there won't be a Mechanicsburg to return to. The Baron plans to destroy the castle and your Lady Heterodyne.
Curzon stepped forward.
This is a serious charge.
From inside his leather coat, Wooster produced a thick oilskin courier packet. He tossed it to the general.
Here are the orders, troop movements and instructions for the attack, and its aftermath.
Curzon snapped open the packet and began flipping through the papers within. Suddenly he paused, then began to scowl as he flipped faster. Within seconds, papers were blizzarding throughout the room as he screamed in rage. Boris broke free and advanced, fists balled in rage.
Do you know what you've done?
Wooster leaned back out the window and grabbed a rope that was hanging beside him.
Destabilized Britain's greatest rival and aided an innocent girl, he replied smugly. A mighty good day's work, I'd say.
Boris screamed in frustration.
She's not innocent, you dupe. She's the other.
Wooster looked serious.
I believe you're wrong, but if she is, then rest assured that Her Majesty will take an interest. You damned spy!
Boris screamed.
I'll kill you!
But as he leapt forward, Wooster simply fell backwards into the open sky. Everyone rushed to the window and peered downward in time to see Wooster pull a small personal flight unit from inside his coat. It was too small to actually fly anywhere, but the British agent was now in a controlled fall that was taking him back towards the town below. A last faint,
Do svidaniya!
Wafted upwards. As Boris stared at the receding figure, a large hand fell on his shoulder. A great feeling of peace washed over Boris. He really had done his best. He closed his eyes and wished his coat was not ripped.
All right,
he said evenly.
Fine. If you're going to kill me, just do it quickly.
There was a pause. Then, to his surprise, a second hand grasped, lifted, and turned him around until he faced the trio of menacing monsters who regarded him from troubled faces. Zog nodded.
Perhaps, but first.
He gently set Boris down onto his feet.
First, you will tell us about Miss Agatha and the other. We is listening.
Chapter 2. One would think that sparks, being on the whole psychotic megalomaniacs with little regard for human life and poor impulse control, would have no friends or indeed any use for people. Quite often they believe this themselves and can often be heard making dramatic statements to this effect. The reason these diatribes are heard by more than just the occasional potted plant or captured hero is this. Sparks quite frequently find themselves surrounded by people, whether they want to be or not. We are not just talking about the stereotypical traveler whose cart breaks down during a storm and thus must seek shelter at the lone castle glimpsed through the trees and so finds himself at a timely ringside seat for the revelation of the latest abomination of science, although there is no denying this happens far more than is statistically probable. No, your seriously steeped in madness dabbler in the esoteric sciences usually finds themselves taxed with a ragtag collection of hangers-on,
typically consisting of minions, constructs, adventurers, and those unique, unclassifiable individuals whose raison d'être appears to be to remind us of what a strange world it is. Even more interestingly, it appears that the greater the spark, the more of these individuals they spontaneously accumulate. Philosophers and other underemployed persons have theorized that this is a natural phenomenon and is simply nature's way of trying to insulate the world from the direct effects of sparks by constantly distracting them. The argument goes that if they were left alone to their own devices, so to speak, they would soon reduce all of human existence to naught but mathematical formulae, and I do not believe that I am speaking figuratively. This theory goes a long way towards explaining the enormous collection of odd persons that have, over time, accreted around Baron Klaus Wulfenbach. Those who believe this phenomenon does not represent some sort of cosmic defense mechanism, and that the greater the spark, the greater the number of distracting persons required to prevent them from bringing about Armageddon, noted with trepidation the number, quality, and sheer strangeness of the people that had already begun to fall into the orbit of the young Lady Heterodyne less than a week after she had publicly revealed herself in Sturmhalten and become known to Europa as a whole. From this, they had drawn rather alarming conclusions, all of which, it turned out, seriously underestimated the events to come. An excerpt from the introduction to Professor Thaddeus Brinstein's What the Hell Was That? Trying to Understand the Legacy of the Long Wars, Transylvania Polygnostic University Press. Ehrman Higgs reached out and grasped a middle-wing set of draperies. These disintegrated into tatters with a firm tug, allowing a wan, dust-filled shaft of light to illuminate the hallway. The doors that punctuated the walls were more elaborately carved than any others they had seen in the castle, and some effort had been made to soften the usual style of decor they had found throughout the rest of the building. Oh, there was still a plethora of fanged monstrosities threatening hapless humans, but here, at least, everybody involved seemed unnaturally cheerful. Higgs nodded in satisfaction.
I'm betting this is where we need to be.
The others looked at each other in confusion. Zetha glanced out the window.
But we haven't gone down anywhere near far enough. We're still above ground.
Sleipnir had opened the nearest door and peeked inside.
These look like they're old bedrooms. Pretty fancy ones, too.
She raised an eyebrow sardonically.
Read your map wrong?
Higgs regarded them blankly. Then he gave a slight sigh.
Thought you folks were smart.
He started walking.
The castle told Herr von Zinser here that the Great Movement Chamber was so secret that even the Heterodyne boys never knew about it. But Miss Agatha found the Lady Lucretia's secret lab in a set of small rooms hidden underneath it.
He pulled his pipe from his pocket and gave it a ruminative suck.
Sparks are like balloon bees. They like to spread out to fill as much space as they can.
Footnote. Balloon bees, Urinaria, Apis, Kylie, Europa, are a species of cave-dwelling honeybee that has adapted to living within airship cells. Their signature characteristic is that they spread out in an enclosed space until they are as far as possible from each other. They then construct small solitary dens. End footnote.
If the Lady Lucretia was set up in those small rooms, it's because she didn't know about, or couldn't get to, the larger room right overhead.
He gave the wall a gentle rap as he kept walking.
A place like Castle Heterodyne, even if you was the boss, I'm betting you'd want to get away from it occasionally. And to do that, you'd have to put your secret room somewhere the castle couldn't see. The Great Movement Chamber was as deep as the castle's perception went, so they stowed it below that.
He stopped outside a bedroom door that, even compared to the others, was ostentatious in the extreme. Gargoyles and assorted monstrosities frolicked in all directions, and the door itself sported inlaid panels of gold and jade.
And the only person who'd know about it would be the Heterodyne.
Oh! Sleipnir snapped her fingers. The Heterodyne boy's father was killed by their mother. He might not have had the opportunity to pass that knowledge down to his son.
This does make sense, Theo chimed in. From stuff I've heard from my family, Lucretia could get anything she wanted from her husband, Bill Heterodyne.
He pushed open the great door and revealed an extremely ornate room, complete with a bed that could easily have comfortably slept a half a dozen people.
And knowing her, I'll bet she even convinced him to give her the master bedroom.
The room was large, but one could see that even in ruins it conveyed a feeling of comfort and power. The outer wall was dominated by a large set of cracked windows and a set of French doors that at one time must have led out to a balcony. This had been ripped away, but there was still a breathtaking view of the town spread out below. In addition to the bed, there was a parlor, a row of elegantly carved armoires, and a spacious, sunken marble tub. The walls were paneled from top to bottom in a reddish wood that, even under the dust and grime of almost two decades, conveyed richness and extravagance. The walls were hung with numerous paintings. It was Zetha, while studying them closely, who realized, "Hey, these all feature the same woman." Theo examined them and nodded.
"That is the Lady Lucretia," he confirmed. "I saw portraits of her in the family gallery back home."
He shook his head.
"My mother always said she loved looking at herself."
Everyone examined the pictures with a renewed interest. Lucretia had been a curvaceous blonde with large, heavy-lidded eyes, a small nose, and sensuous lips. In every picture, the artists had managed to convey a sense of mischief and the underlying cruelty that one found in the most pernicious of practical jokers.
"So that's Agatha's mom?"
Moloch asked.
"She doesn't look that dangerous."
"Nevertheless, that's the woman who became the Other, destroyed a whole bunch of great houses, and rules the Geisterdomen,"
Cross reminded him. While everyone else examined the paintings, Higgs was slowly walking the perimeter of the room, tapping lightly on the walls. Finally, he stopped, reached out, and gave a nondescript section of paneling a firm shove. With a faint groan, a narrow door fell inward, raising a cloud of dust. He nodded in satisfaction. The head of a darkened stairway could be seen.
"I'll bet that goes straight down to her hidden lab."
Theo nodded.
"A nice little chain of logic there, Mr. Higgs. Well done."
As they filed through the door, Zetha laid a hand on Higgs's sleeve.
"Wait a minute. How did you know where the master bedroom was?"
she asked quietly. Higgs looked at her with raised eyebrows.
"It was on the map."
The passage wound down and down and down. They descended in single file, with Higgs leading the way. Cross was fascinated.
"This thing must connect to secret doors throughout half the castle."
Moloch hunched his shoulders.
"I'm just amazed there wasn't a trap every 2 meters.
Snaug considered this.
"This is a place the castle intelligence didn't go. Maybe there weren't any."
Moloch snorted.
"If I was one of the whack jobs who built this place, it's where I'd make sure there were traps."
Higgs listened as he stealthily disarmed yet another trap. He nodded. Young von Zinzer would fit in just fine. Eventually, they came to a door that, when opened, revealed the ruins of Lucretia's secret lab. They all exclaimed at the sight of the collapsed ceiling and immediately spread out to look for Agatha and the others. Crosp and Moloch gazed back at the stairway, which continued on deeper into the earth. Moloch scratched his beard.
"So there are secret rooms under the secret room?"
Crosp grinned.
"Exploring this place is going to be very interesting."
He clapped Moloch on the back.
"You'll have to tell me all about it."
Zetha was searching near the pile of debris when she stumbled against an unstable rock, striking it with her shoulder. A small cascade of rubble began, and Higgs yanked her out of the way just as a large stone block dislodged and fell. She looked at the cracked floor beneath it and turned to Higgs.
"Thanks. I was careless."
This was clearly not the response Higgs had been expecting. To cover, he gestured at the pile with the stem of his pipe.
"We have to risk it to find the others, but this whole thing is unstable. Could come down at any minute. You keep searching. I'll keep my eye on you."
Zetha nodded, but at that moment there was a shout from Theo.
"It's okay! They all survived!"
He was holding a wad of notes that had been placed on the same bench as the comatose von Pin.
"Then where are they?"
Crosp asked.
"They've gone to fix the castle."
He read further and frowned.
They say that the fake Heterodyne girl is still loose." "Huh. Gil says she's someone he met in Paris, and she's a lot more dangerous than she looks."
He looked up.
"They want us to take care of Madame von Pin."
He shook his head.
"I can't say they left us with the easier job."
Moloch leaned into Fräulein Snaug.
Oh, I don't know. You mean I get to stay in a fortified secret room while a bunch of sparks race around trying to fix this death machine of a castle? Twist my arm.
Snaug looked at his defenseless little arm and shivered.
Soon enough,
she promised herself. Aloud, she said,
But first we'd better shore up this ceiling.
By Von Pin's bedside, Theo was finishing up a quick examination and frequently referencing the sheaf of notes he'd found. Sleipnir stood by, passing instruments as requested. She bit her lip.
Poor Von Pin. She looks so vulnerable.
Theo nodded.
At least she's stable.
He laid down his stethoscope and shook his head in admiration.
This setup they put together is amazing. I think she could lie here for the next few months if she had to.
So what should we do?
Theo again shuffled through the notes.
They didn't leave me any specific instructions, which is flattering, but not particularly useful.
He flipped a page and then frowned for a second.
Ah, look here,
he said, not showing Sleipnir anything.
Gil, Agatha, and Prince Sturmvirus all worked on this. They've annotated each other back and forth.
A light seemed to go on inside his head.
Oh, yes, I see. Amazing. And I think I can even improve this.
He looked up, and his voice began to drop into the registers associated with the activation of the spark.
Yes, I've got everything I need already here. By the time you,
he pointed at Mr. Higgs,
get that watchdog clank down here, I can have all of the preliminary work done and then some.
He wheeled about and gave Sleipnir a crazed grin.
I can do this!
Sleipnir gave a tiny growl and slipped her arms around Theo's neck.
Now that's the brilliantly sparky beast I ran off with.
Theo swept her up in his arms and cackled softly.
Care to assist me?
Sleipnir gazed up at him through half-lidded eyes.
Ooh, yes, master.
Moloch's overly loud throat clearing barely registered.
We're just gonna leave and go tell the others how to get down here.
He began backing away.
And we're gonna do it really slowly.
Zetha nodded.
Yeah, and, we're gonna go with them.
Higgs glanced down and noticed the heat coming off the couple before him had spontaneously ignited his pipe.
And then we'd better go look for the Lady Heterodyne.
Crosp waved a paw.
Too much running around. I'll just wait here.
2 seconds later, he had been forcibly hauled out of the room by the collar of his coat.
What is your problem?
He groused as the party trudged back up the stairs.
Haven't you ever watched that sort of thing? It's hilarious.
Privately, Zetha had to agree with him.
Everybody deserves a bit of privacy.
Crosp shrugged.
Whatever.
Moloch stomped upwards, shaking his head.
Sparks,
he muttered.
They're crazy, the lot of them.
Beside him, Fräulein Snaug glanced at him coyly.
I think it's romantic.
He glanced at her with a touch of concern.
You've been hanging around Sparks too much.
Oh, come now, Herr von Zinzer. Have you no romance in your soul?
A look of mild regret passed briefly through the man's eyes. Then he shrugged.
Dunno. Never had a chance to find out.
Hexalina looked skeptical.
No, a dashing fellow like yourself?
Moloch snorted.
The word you want isn't dashing, it's fleeing.
Oh, but surely there's some girl somewhere who's caught your eye.
Well.
Hexalina was astonished at the feelings that swept over her at this.
Yes,
she prodded. Moloch concentrated on putting one foot in front of the other, but his face slowly went red.
Well, I do kind of like Sanaa.
Snaug stopped dead.
Sanaa? Sanaa Wilhelm?
Moloch nodded.
I knew you'd know her. She's been in here longer than me.
He glanced at the look on Snaug's face and gave a self-deprecating shrug.
I know. Crazy, ain't it?
She will die.
Snaug whispered. Moloch blinked.
What was that?
Snaug grinned maniacally and gave him a jaunty thumbs up.
I said, never say die, you know? Good luck.
Her canines glinted in the light. Moloch smiled.
Thanks.
Some vague feeling urged him to change the subject.
So how is it, working with Middlemint?
Snag blinked.
Oh, he's very supportive of my needs.
Yeah, that's good.
Snag glanced down at her hands, the hands that would never be truly clean.
I wouldn't call it good.
At that moment, there was a scream and a brilliant actinic flare from the room directly before them, the room where they had left the three scientists. With a blur and a gust of displaced air, Zetha and Higgs shot ahead. They paused in the doorway just long enough to see the scientists sprawled about, and Zola furiously clutching at a smoking hand. She gave an animal snarl and, without hesitation, dove into the great shaft melted into the floor. As she dropped, she produced her grappling gun and fired it upwards, catching a protruding beam. With a jerk, she swung herself to the side, released, and gracefully rolled into a pile of crumbling old furniture on a lower floor, then sprang to her feet and headed into the shadows. Seconds later, Zetha followed. She had leapt from floor to floor in a tightly controlled acrobatic fall. As she stood, she heard a cracking thump and spun to see Airman Higgs straightening up from a small impact crater. She smiled. His positioning made it look as if the airshipman had simply leapt down from several stories. Her smile faltered. How had he?
Where did she go?
Zetha's thoughts were derailed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.